We're here with John Krieger, who's the owner of Krieger Barrels. John, if you were to be asked, what's your personal philosophy or mission statement for your company in terms of barrel making, what would that be?
Well, basically myself and actually everybody in the company have one concern, that's just to make the best barrels we can make, hopefully the best barrel that's ever been made, and to try and keep as much as humanly possible every customer happy.
Would you say that barrels are getting better than ever? We keep seeing new records being set.
Yeah, everything is getting better. All the technologies, the barrels, the bullets, the powders, primers, the knowledge of the shooters and the reloading techniques, everything is getting better. It's just a natural thing. It's always been improved, and competition brings that out.
What about metallurgy? Do we have better steel than we did 10 years ago?
Not 10 years ago, I wouldn't say, but I think maybe historically, going back to the 50s and 60s, the chrome stainless was more homogenous and uniform than the chrome moly, so that it kind of went to the top as far as target barrels go. But nowadays, the steel is so good that I don't feel there's any difference accuracy-wise between chrome moly and stainless. Everything's a trade-off. There's different characteristics you get with one use than another.
John, we're often asked, is a straight contour barrel more accurate than, let's say, a heavy varmint taper? What's the answer?
I don't know if anybody's determined if any particular taper is more accurate. Just generally speaking, all other things being equal, a heavier gun is easier to shoot accurately. It's more forgiving for position variations and so forth. As far as an actual contour and vibrations, though, I don't know. I couldn't say if one is better than another.
Another question we often get is, should I flute my barrel? Will I be giving up accuracy? What do you have to say to those questioners?
No, with a cut rifle barrel, you don't have the stress that's involved in other barrels. With a cut rifle barrel, we pre-turn, drill, finish turn, flute before we ever do the critical insight, reaming and rifling dimensions. Whereas with, for example, butt rifle barrel, everything has to be done after the barrel is rifled and stress relieved.
So you're saying a cut rifle process is makes it easier to flute a barrel?
Yeah, it's less chance, or really no chance of creating a problem, whereas if there's residual stress in another rifling method, it can present itself in, you know, an accuracy situation. A button rifle barrel, for example, has to be in a uniform cylinder when it's rifled to resist the button equally. And then all the turning and fluting and so forth is done afterwards. With a cut rifle barrel, it is a new. I kind of put it this way: with a button rifle barrel, you should return and so forth, but you can. With a cut rifle barrel, you can, but you don't have to, because you're not inducing any stress into it.
Speaking of stress, we often hear about stress relieving. You do this to your barrels at multiple stages in production, don't you?
Correct. Yeah, the steel mill double stress relieves the steel to begin with. And when we get it, we cryogenically treat it. And the reason for that is, what the metallurgists tell me, they dummy it down for me. And then basically, when the mill quenches and tempers the steel, there's two grain structures that we're concerned with, martensite and austenite. Both have stress in them. The martensite will respond to the heat stress relieving, but the austenite doesn't. When you cryogenically treat the steel, the austenite is converted into martensite. And now you can take that new martensite, which is real in stress relieving, you essentially have relieved all the stress that's in the barrel. We do it to the steel right up front, because you get better steel, more homogenous, more uniform, more stress-free, you just make a better barrel, better steel, better barrel.
Oftentimes, we see shooters at the range sawing their cleaning rods and brushes back and forth across the end of their barrel. Certainly, there are people who say, there's no way that you can hurt a steel barrel with a bronze brush. What's your thinking about moving a brush across the crown?
Yeah, I hate to see it. It's not a matter of the bronze. And what's happening is you've got carbon and glass from the priming and so forth. They're actually the bronze bristles, which are softer than the barrel steel, act as a lap. That's how a lap works. The abrasives will adhere to the softer material, and then it will machine or lap or grind or whatever you want to call it, the harder steel. So I don't like to see anything being dragged across the crown. The crown is one of the most critical parts of the barrel, and you know, see more damage there. A lot of times somebody will think a barrel is shot out, all it needs is re-crowning.
So what should someone do when they stick the brush out past the end of the bore?
Well, if they want to use a brush, I would say unscrew it, you know, I mean, don't drag it back across the crown. But I'm not a slave to cleaning myself. I can't see the, first of all, it's not a benign operation. There's a lot of damage done with it. And the, I never saw the wisdom in getting the barrel squeaky clean and then have to fire a bunch of fouling shots to get it to settle down again.
Great. John, thank you very much. We appreciate your time.